नमस्कार, वेलकम टू दी उपन्यास मालिका लेक्चर सीरीज 3 ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द नेशनल असेसमेंट एंड एक्रेडिटेशन काउंसिल बेंगलुरु एंड ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द डायरेक्टर नैक आई वेलकम ईच ऑफ द पर्संस फॉर द टुडे लेक्चर सीरीज 3. टुडेज टॉपिक इज क्वालिटी असेसमेंट इन हायर एजुकेशन एंड रोल ऑफ एक्रेडिटिंग एजेंसीज. Let me start with the program with a small prayer. Vakratunda Mahakaya Surya Koti Samaprabha Nirvignam Kurume Deva Sarva Kareshu Sarvada Saraswati Namastubhyam Varade Kamarupini Vidyarambhyam Karishyami Siddhir Bhavatu Me Sada Akhanda Mandalakaram Vyaptam Yena Characharam Tattvadam Datitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Respect to the all the teachers and faculty members and all the viewers who are listening and seeing this Upanyasa Malika, on behalf of the NAC, I welcome each participant for this program. Aap sabko is karyakram mein hardik swagat hai. Today, we are having the topic Quality Assessment in Higher Education and Role of Accrediting Agencies. We have two speakers with us. The first speaker will be our director, Professor S.C. Sharmaji, the director NAC, who will be speaking on the quality assessment in higher education. Professor Sharma is the director NAC who has taken charge of the NAC 2 years back, and he has motivated many colleges and universities undergoing the process for assessment and accreditation. He will be speaking on the quality assessment in higher education. One more speaker we have, Professor S. Srikanta Swami, the former principal of the RV Teachers College and also the former director of the research in Christ University and presently working as an academic expert in the NAC. Professor Swami will be speaking on the role of accrediting agencies. I just would like to share a small word with you. Quality is a continuous process. Quality of higher education institutions depends upon the 3 QIs. The first QI is the quality individuals. It may be the faculty, students, non-teaching staff, and the management, and also the alumni. It depends upon the individuals who are working in that particular institution. The second QI, if the quality individuals are good in the institution, then the quality institution will be there. If we have quality institution and quality individuals, I think we can make a quality India. On behalf of the NAC, I welcome each participant for this program. May I now request Professor S.C. Sharmaji, the director NAC, to speak on quality assessment in higher education.
Namaskars to all of you. In today's lecture series, it is Introduction to Quality Assessment in Higher Education. Quality assessment in higher education is nothing but process of documenting, often times in measurable terms, knowledge, skills, attitude, beliefs. India has one of the largest and diverse education systems in the world. In fact, privatization, widespread expansion, increased autonomy, and introduction of programs in new and emerging areas have improved access to higher education. And it has led to widespread concern on quality and relevance of the higher education. Now, why do we go in for accreditation is a question. Most of the higher education institutions and universities, the staff may have a feeling, oh, it is a ritual process. No, but why? What is the reason of being accredited? What are its benefits? This is a diagnostic tool, in fact, where your strength, weakness, opportunities are can be deciphered from 1 to 7 criteria, and then identification of internal areas of planning and resource allocation. You see, that is what in the NEP planning, it says that IDP, in institutional development planning, so that when you see your strength, weakness, etc., you can develop a plan. And funding agencies look for objective data and performance funding, that is very important, and then sense of direction and identity for institutions. Societies look for reliable information on quality education offered, and intra and inter-institutional interaction, this happens. And then you know, the then what is the eligibility criteria? Of course, it says that 2 batches of students to should go out, so that, or 6 years of existence, so that it proves the stability of the institution, and you have some data for evaluation. And universities, there are now at present, there are central, state, private, deemed to be universities, and institutions of national importance. And in the new education policy 2020, all the universities are termed as, only bracketed as, universities. Now coming here, NAC will not consider any unapproved off campuses for accreditation and assessment. And these institutions have provided that these institutions have regular students enrolled in to the full time teaching and research programs offered on campus. Of course, you have all these things on our website. And duly established campuses within the country, if any, shall be treated as part of university institutions of national importance for accreditation and assessment process. As I told you just now, NAC will not undertake the accreditation of offshore campuses. Offshore campuses are still, we are not doing it. And autonomous colleges, constituent colleges, affiliated to universities recognized by UGC as an affiliating universities. These are some of the things which we take notice of. And colleges are affiliated to university recognized by UGC for the purposes of affiliation. Constituent colleges of a private and deemed to be universities are considered as constituent units of the universities, and thus will not be considered for A&A independently. Such constituent colleges need to come along with the university. So, the part of regulatory authorities are very important. For example, engineering should be recognized by AICTE, and nursing council, so on and so forth. You know, there are a lot of the statutory bodies, and this has been recognized by Association of Indian Universities, AIU, or such other government agencies concerned as equivalent to a degree program of a university. These are all some of the points where we see whether it has been recognized by the statutory bodies. And applying for reassessment subsequent cycles 2, 3, and 4, there's considerable improvement in the accreditation status. May apply for reassessment after a minimum of 1 year. This is the limitation period, and then they should come within 3 years also. These are all some of the fundamental things which are available on the website. And cycle 2, 3, 4 of accreditation can submit the institutional information for quality assessment, IIQA, during the last 6 months of validity period, subject to the fulfillment of other conditions specified by NAC from time to time for purposes. A&A process of NAC continues to be an exercise in partnership with HEI being assessed. So, stakeholders as well as the developments in the national scenario of higher education all have contributed in making appropriate revisions in the process so as to accelerate the process with greater rigor. Now, revised assessment and accreditation framework of NAC. You see, as all of you know, the earlier, that is during 2017, the whole NAC process was subjective. Here what we have done is subjective and objective, and of course everything is driven by ICT. There is a paradigm shift in making it ICT enabled, totally ICT enabled, and the processes are simplified, drastic reduction in the number of questions, size of the self-study report, reduction in the number of peer team visit days. And these are all some of the modifications that we have brought in. And then, you know, we have our system generated scores. Online evaluation is for 70% and peer team judgment is for 30%. Of course, the whole thing, even the peer team selection, is also done by ICT. And before submission of the SSR, you have the pre-qualification, that is for 25% if higher education institution gets ill, the institution will be allowed to submit the SSR. And then, you know, the process starts. Once you submit the SSR, the third party validation, that is data verification and validation, takes place. And in revising several metrics to bring in enhanced participation of students and alumni in the assessment process has also been taken place, and with due weightage is being given. And quality indicator frameworks. What is this? All of us know about quality criterion 1 to 7, that is curriculum, teaching, learning, research, infrastructure, student support, governance, and institutional values. These are some of the important things which everything revolves on these 7 criteria. And under this criteria, we have a few key indicators which are identified and are delineated as metrics, which are actually meant to elicit responses from higher education institutions. The assessment process, taking cognizance of the diversity of in the kinds of institutions, HEIs have grouped under 3 categories. One is university, autonomous colleges, affiliated. The assessment process will be carried out in 3 stages, that is the self-study report, student satisfaction survey, and peer team reports. These are important things. And SSR has about 115 metrics for universities, 107 metrics for college autonomous, and 93 and 96 metrics for UG and PG. And SSR has 2 kinds of metrics, one those of quantifiable, and the other is the qualitative metrics, QLM. Of course, the distribution of metrics and key indicators across criteria, please log on to our website and you find all the details there, and what is the QLM and QNM. Procedural details: eligible higher education institutions seeking A&A are required to submit IIQA from online any time during the year. Repeatedly, you know, if they fail, each is permitted 3 attempts in a year with a single fee. So this is there in the website. And then after that, your SSR have to be submitted, and within 45 days, the duration is 45 days. And those institutions who fail to submit SSR within 45 days will have to apply, starting from IIQA and its fees. And it is to be noted that extension for submission of SSR will be possible if the request is made by the HEI before the expiry of stipulated time. This is important. And then your SSR can be uploaded, and of course SSR has to be submitted only online. Again, 70% will be quantitative and 30% will be qualitative. The website gives you all the details. And DVB is the most important aspect of it, where 70% of it is by DVB, and the DVB is very strong. It verifies all the metrics and portal to portal from HEIs, you know, the assessment takes place. And after DVB, NAC will intimate the HEI regarding the status of pre-qualification. Only those institutions which have got 25% will go to the next round of assessment to be done, that is the peer team visits. And the most important thing is student satisfaction survey. SSS will be conducted simultaneously with the DVB process. See, the point is, while assessing higher education institutions, the clients or the stakeholders are students. So the student's opinion is taken, and there are certain weightages given for it. And while calculating the scores, QLM and QNM, the student satisfaction survey is also embedded in this particular thing, which is a very innovative concept in the RAF revised accreditation framework. Now, peer team visits the institutions and then gives the QLM score, and finally the ICT takes the score and evaluates for qualitative and quantitative. And this is all about the fundamental and preliminary work. For more details, you can always get into the NAC website and take it forward. Thank you very much. Namaste. Thank you.
Respected professors from various higher education institutions, special invitees and friends. At the outset, I thank our director, Professor Sharmaji, for his initiative with respect to the conduct of the 12 lecture series under the heading Upanyasa Malika. This is the third one we are doing it, and he has already covered the first part of today's the main theme. The second part is remaining with me, and I am going to start the same thing. Before I could start, I wanted to start with a statement. Education is the most powerful weapon which can use to change the world. This is what Nelson Mandela has mentioned. When you educate a person, you can change a life. When you educate many, you are going to change the whole world. Therefore, the purpose, the aim, and the concern of higher education institution is to act like an agent of social change, to bring lot of changes by means of which the country can progress. I think so far you have heard how exactly the different steps have been followed in the A&A process. I am going to take it further with respect to the different agencies which are there along with the NAC, and I am going to give you a brief idea regarding how these different accrediting agencies are going to perform and in what way you are going to get the benefit out of this. Now, to start with, I mentioned here NAC, NIRF, NBA, and also about ARW and QSWR. I think these are the four important accrediting agencies that I am going to talk today. Now, NAC, quality improvement in education system, is mainly related to teaching, evaluation techniques, results, and placement of institution. The National Assessment Accreditation Council, formed under the aegis of University Grants Commission, has implemented new methodology, and NAC is giving more emphasis upon the different dimensions of quality measure by means of which quality of the institutions can be assessed, and based on that, the institutions can also be accredited. NAC was established in 1994, and ever since the establishment of NAC, it has involved in accrediting the different universities as well as colleges under different cycles. From 2017 onwards, it has introduced the revised accreditation framework, which is more objective in nature, as discussed by our director, and all the details are also available on our NAC website. In support of the quality sustenance, the NAC has also helped the institutions financially to organize various state and national seminars, workshops in the related topics, and provide platforms for stakeholders to debate on the topics which are useful for the quality enhancement in higher education system. The higher education institutions are assessed and accredited by studying and analyzing them on the various parameters towards the quality measures. Friends, this is important. Unless the higher education institution is familiar about the different parameters adopted by an accrediting agency, it may be very difficult for them to cope up and get the expected accreditation grade. Within the broad framework, the NAC's process for decision making on the outcome of the accreditation exercise has the following important three steps. Step number one, key aspect wise grade and grade points. Step two, criterion wise grade point average and criterion grade. And in step three, cumulative grade point average and also about the institutional grade. I think these details are also available. And in my opinion, lot of preparation is essential on the part of the higher education institutions. Step number one is to acquaint themselves about the complete process that is involved based upon different parameters that are used. I think this is very, very important. If you lack in the first stage of preparing and acquainting yourselves with the assessment process, you may find it difficult to do justice to the different metrics which comes under the different key indicators. The Quality Assurance Agency for Higher Education, there are different agencies are there, and these agencies, they do follow more or less the general criteria, more or less it is same. However, there can be slight variation with respect to the parameters followed by one accrediting agency to the other. It is the independent body that checks on standards and quality in higher education. It conducts quality assessment reviews, develops reference points and guidance for providers, and conducts or commissions research and relevant issues. The National Institutional Ranking Framework, this is the first one I am going to just speak on. The National Institutional Ranking Framework, it was approved by the MHRD and launched by Honorable Minister of Human Resource Development on 29th September 2015. There are separate rankings for different types of institutions depending on their areas of operations, like whether it is a university or a college, whether it is a technical or engineering institution, whether it is a management institution or pharmacy institutions or architecture institutions. Like that, depending upon the nature of the higher education institution, they are going to give the ranks depending upon the parameters which are applicable to them. The framework outlines a methodology to rank institutions across the country. Therefore, framework is very important. Like NAC has got its own framework for assessment and accreditation. Similarly, NIRF also has a framework and follows a methodology. The methodology draws from the overall recommendations, broad understanding arrived at by a core committee set up by MHRD. MHRD sets up a core committee, therefore they work out the methodology based upon the broader framework to identify the broad parameters for ranking various universities and institutions. Therefore, the committee's responsibility is to work out the different parameters. Now, the parameters are broadly covered under the five headings. Teaching, learning, and resources. This is one parameter the NIRF is considering. Research and professional practices, another. Graduation outcomes, the third one. Outreach and inclusivity, that is another important parameter. And the last one is about the perception of the peer. This is also equally important when they wanted to rate. Now, the other features are, methodology is based on developing a set of metrics for ranking of academic institutions based on the parameters agreed upon by the core committee. Our core committee consensus is necessary when they move on referring to the parameters for university to engineering college, maybe engineering to pharmacy, like that. These parameters are organized into five broad heads, as I mentioned earlier, and have been further elaborated into suitable subheads That means under each broader parameter, there are subheadings are also there. Each broad head has an overall weight assigned to it. Within each head, the various subheads also have an appropriate weight distribution. Like we are having in NAC, key indicator is there. Within that, we have got the metrics. Similarly, here also they have got a broader parameter. Within that, they have got the metric. Broader parameter also has a total weightage, and within that, the metrics also have got the weightage. An attempt is also made to identify the relevant data needed to suitably measure the performance score under each subhead. Emphasis here is on identifying the data that the institution can easily provide or easy to obtain from third-party sources and easily verifiable. A friend, this is equally important. If an institution is providing a particular type of data, it has to give 100% guarantee that the data is correct. And any third party verifies in terms of, we say third party, our DVV like, they should be able to convince with the data, with the evidences provided pertaining to the data, that is equally important. Most of the institutions, they provide the data, assuming that the possibility or the probability of verifying is less. That is not true. Any data given by a higher education institution, the experts have got a mechanism by means of which that they can verify. And if the data and the evidences for the data, if they are matching, I think the chances of getting a better mark, better grade is more. This is important in the interest of maintaining the transparency. Therefore, they also will maintain transparency. This is very important. In my opinion, a good accrediting agency is one which has got beautiful parameters based upon the scientific ground, applicable for higher education institutions, the way in that they are functioning. And apart from that, how best they maintain the transparency, how best they come out with the concept of public disclosure, accordingly, the accrediting agency will get the credit. A suitable metric is then proposed based on the data, which computes a score under each subhead. The subhead scores are then added to obtain a scores for each individual head. The overall score is computed based on the weights allotted to each head. The overall score can take a maximum value of 100. The institution can then be ranked order based on their scores. Now, I think this is what they do. To give a little more elaboration, the first parameter is teaching, learning, and resources. Under that, we have got the subheadings. Or what we call that subheadings, or we call it as metrics, like student strength. That is equally important. They give weightage to the student strength, including the doctoral studies. Then faculty student ratio. A good higher education institution, friends, as you know, if the faculty student ratio also speaks about the quality, student strength also speaks about the quality. Greater the demand, somewhere it shows that the quality of the institution is good, and the stakeholders have noticed that. In that way, the institution, because of its final and beautiful way of functioning, with a lot of commitment to the quality, is able to attract the students from different countries. It is possible that a good institution can attract the students not only from the neighboring community, not only from the neighboring states, but also from the other countries. Then combined metric for faculty with PhD. I think this is mandatory, and we want the faculty members to have the PhD degree. Thereby, they know how to tackle a particular problem based upon the scientific method. There were little weightages also given to that, including the experience. Then financial resources and their utilization. I think equally important. How an institution maintain sustenance with respect to its financial resources, and within the resources available, how best it is going to do justice in utilizing the fund for the welfare of the students, and also to create a good futuristic plan for the institution. Then the second broader parameter is research and professional practice, or we call it as RP. Under this RP also, we have got some key indicators or metrics, like combined metric for publications, then combined metric for quality publications, IPR and patents. patents published and granted, footprints of projects, professional practices, and executive development programs. I think very good, especially for a higher education institution, this is very important. In fact, UGC also insists that all those students who are doing PhD, in the process of doing their PhD, they have to publish at least 2 papers in a refereed journal, which has got high impact factor. This is very, very important, because unless they write, unless they exhibit their own research work, it is not possible for other people to know what is going on in an education institution, and at the same time, what is that area of specialization that they have taken. Now, friends, that's why we are insisting on publication for higher education institutions, and quality of publication is equally important, including the patents. Now, the next one is about the graduation outcomes. Higher education experts are also have defined what is this graduation outcomes, or what are the graduation outcomes. We speak in terms of learning outcomes, we speak in terms of course outcome, we speak in terms of program outcome. In that way, graduation outcome is also equally important. Higher education institutions should do justice to this. Here, the 2 broader indicators that they have used here are the metric for university examinations, metric for number of PhD students graduated. I think these 2 are equally important. Then, apart from this, we have got the next parameter, outreach and inclusivity or inclusiveness. Percentage of students from other states, other countries. I think most of you must have experienced, sir, our institution is in the rural side. How do we expect the students from other countries? How do we expect from other countries, other states and other countries? I think the idea is good, because you have to gear up for tomorrow. You have to visualize about the tomorrow's demand. Therefore, in case it is not possible for you to attract the students from the neighboring countries, try to attract them from the neighboring states, if not from the neighboring districts. That is how you have to start initially with this kind of commitment, makes you that your institution is going to be visible for the different countries, and lot of demand can also be created. Then similarly, the another important point is with respect to the percentage of women diversity, women empowerment programs. In what way you are committed to women welfare? I think an institution should prove this by proving that with lot of evidences, with lot of commitment, they also can say that they are for women empowerment and they are serving for the cause of women education. Economically and socially challenged students, I think our national education policy also speaks about the socially economically deprived group. They call it a socially economically deprived, SEDG. And therefore, unless you bring the deprived class into the mainstream, you are not doing social justice. Our education will be incomplete if you are not going to attract the students from the minority institutions, minority group, or the deprived or marginalized group. Therefore, this parameter is equally important. And by doing justice to this parameter, possibility of getting more course that adds on to the total score. Then, economically and socially challenged, I have mentioned. Facilities for physically challenged students, Divyangjan, we say. So physically challenged students should also be attracted to the mainstream. Therefore, they should, one possibility, there are exclusively institutions meant for physically challenged students. They can go, they can continue their studies there. Apart from that, higher education institutions should also have an open door to invite these physically challenged students, allow them to join the mainstream, move with the other students. Thereby, they can overcome their inferiority complex, and they also can just say they can contribute to this great nation. That's why emphasis is also given to this particular point. The next one is about the perception. Perception means what the students have got perception about the institution, what perception the staff members have got about the institution, stakeholders have got the perception towards the higher education institution. In that way, perception is also equally important. Higher the percentage, the greater the percentage of perception, it speaks that the institution is doing well. Then under the peer perception, peer friends, peer group friends, their perception is equally important. As I mentioned, the employer's perception, and apart from that, the academic peer, that is also equally important in order to make an institution, make the flag of the institutions to go higher and higher. I think this is how I think we are giving the grades, like teaching and learning, 100 marks. Research and professional practice, 100. Graduation outcomes, 100. Outreach, 100. Perception, 100. Whereas the weightage changes from one parameter to the other parameter. First one, they have given only 0.30, 0.30 per second. For the third one, graduation outcomes, they have given 0.20. Outreach and inclusivity, they have given 0.10, because many institutions may not do justice to this area. And the perception also that they have given 0.10. Now, friends, I think that is how the NIRF is functioning, and the peer team visit may not be there, but based upon whatever the data that you are providing, they consolidate it, experts will consolidate it based upon the weightage, and they declare the rank. And you can just look into website of the NIRF website, you will get some more detail. Therefore, what the NAC is doing, slightly it may be different compared to what the NIRF is doing. NIRF emphasis is upon giving the ranks, and the NAC's emphasis upon identifying the institution and giving a grade to the institution in terms of A++, A, B, B++, in terms of the grade that it is giving. But both of them are doing well, but the emphasis, it may slightly vary, but both these two agencies have proved that the way in which they are conducting, the way in which they have assigned the ranks, those institutions are really deserving and they are doing better. Therefore, some of them will go for NAC assessment only, and some of them will go for both the NAC accreditation as well as the NIRF ranking. It is left for the institutions to take up depending upon the benefits what they are going to get. Now, the next one what I am going to touch upon is about the National Board of Accreditation, or NBA. It was initially established by the AACT earlier, All India Council of Technical Education, under the Section 10U of AACT Act as early as 1994, in order to assess the qualitative competence of the programs offered by education institutions from diploma level to postgraduate level in engineering and technology. Therefore, initially, they were emphasizing more upon the technological courses, but later on added management, pharmacy, architecture, and other related disciplines which are approved by AACT. Therefore, AACT approves, a regulatory authority approves the courses. Whatever the programs or the courses approved by AACT, I think NBA can do accreditation regarding those programs. NBA came into existence as an independent autonomous body like that of our NAC, with effect from 7th January 2010. With the objectives of assurance of quality and relevance to technical education, especially of the programs in professional and technical disciplines, engineering and technology, management, as I mentioned earlier, architecture, pharmacy, nowadays even hotel management and catering technology. Therefore, new courses also have been accredited, and all these courses which have been approved by, I think NBA will take up for the accreditation. The NBA conducts evaluation of programs of technical institutes on the basis of laid down norms. Norms are very, very important. Keeping the benchmark, keeping the norms, they go for accreditation. This may include, but not limited to, institutional missions and objectives, organization and governance, they take into consideration. Infrastructure facilities, like we are also having as one of the criteria. Then quality of teaching and learning, that is our second criteria in our out of the 7 criteria what we follow in our NAC accreditation procedure. They also have taken teaching and learning. Curriculum design, we also will refer to curriculum aspect. And then reviews also, then support services, whatever that they are giving, like maybe the library or laboratory or computer laboratory. Then instrumentation and computer facilities, what they are providing, like that. Many aspects have been taken. Friends, here one point you have to remember. Any accrediting agency wanted to accredit any higher education institution, they should have a database indirectly regarding what has been prescribed as per the regulatory body on one hand, what the institution is carrying on the other hand, and whatever the activities that the institution is carrying on, all experts taking the overall activities which are expected to be performed by higher education institutions, the experts will suggest the different norms that are to be followed. That is why they have evolved the different norms depending upon various aspects there. This will help the graduates produced by the institutions as per industry requirements. Now, this is equally important, because if you produce the graduates, they go to different fields. But whereas from the technical side or from the management side, if you are producing the graduates or postgraduates, usually industrial people are waiting to take them, like pharmacy, many industries are there. Therefore, one way, whenever they go for accrediting, NBA also will keep an idea about the placement aspect, and at the same time, the expectations of the industries, whether there would be any kind of academy and industry relationship, that is very, very important. What industries expects, these academicians should try to equip to a greater extent some of the skills, some of the knowledges, some of the competencies, what they require in industry that they have to take care of. That's why I think this point is very important. Then over the period of its existence, the NBA has introduced a new process, new parameter. Like NAC, earlier we had a method of performing with a different weightage to qualitative as well as quantitative metrics. From July 2017 onwards, we have modified slightly. We have got more weightage to quantitative aspect and little less weightage to qualitative aspect. Thereby, this revised recognition framework, it has become the institution friendly, more objective, more transparent, more robust in its nature. In the same way, NBA also, at different levels of different periods of time, it has adopted and brought so many changes with respect to its parameters and criteria, in line with the best international practices and oriented to assess the outcomes of the programs. There was a period where we used to keep the parameters keeping the expectations of the country. Now, in the name of globalization, we have to keep the global standards. We have to keep the expectations of the students who are all over the world. And accordingly, if we can just provide education, I think possible for us to maintain good standards, which in turn capable of attracting the students. That's why we speak in terms of internationalization of education. Now, the objectives of this NBA are very clear: to assess and accredit the technical education, to evolve standards and parameters. There was some way the benchmark is important, and maintaining the standard and setting standard is equally important. Setting standard, keeping the expectations of our country, and keeping the setting the standards, keeping the expectations of the outsiders. Then to promote excellence through a benchmarking. This is also equally important. How to establish the benchmark? Without proper benchmarking, it is very difficult to compare the performance of the institutions. There was somewhere or the other, benchmarking is equally important. They do justice to it. To promote quality consciousness and quality conscious system of technical education. I think quality cannot happen all of a sudden, number one. Number two, if you maintain quality without maintaining sustainability, I think that is not proper. A good higher education institution or a technical education should prove the quality and keep on maintaining the same quality and start moving a little bit higher. I think that is what we expect a particular institution to have good sustainable atmosphere. To build a technical education system as facilitator of human resources. I think the technical education provides larger percentage of human resources for industry, for the general fields and other areas. Therefore, the technical know-how is also equally important. And at the same time, to build a technical education system to facilitate the human resources development is equally important. There were more weightage. This is also one of the objectives of that. Then to set the quality benchmarks targeted at global and national stock pile of human capital. Human capital is important. Many experts also will speak in terms of human index, human resource index. Therefore, human capital. Therefore, I think the strength of a nation depends upon the human capital. The human resource index, which is equally important. To conduct evaluation of self-assessment and technical institutions and programs offered by them on the basis of guidelines, norms, and standards specified by it. I think this is also equally important. NAC also insists on that. Any kind of institution which is interested in competing with other higher education institutions in terms of quality, if they are conscious about the parameters, criteria, whatever we follow, they also can do self-assessment. Internal mechanism that they can develop. Internal auditing can be done. By means of internal auditing or academic and administrative auditing, it is possible for them to know where they stand, and then they can expect external agencies to come and accredit. Therefore, they have got this idea. They wanted to empower the technical education institutions to have self-assessment mechanism to contribute to the domain knowledge in quality parameters. This is equally important. Contribute to the domain knowledge in quality parameters. Assessment and evaluation. Therefore, one is everywhere the knowledge is expanding. Therefore, how do we justice to the knowledge whatever we are producing in our higher education institutions? And then how do we assess the performance of the students? How do you evaluate and find out whatever the curricular transaction we do inside the class is effective and resulted in making the students to acquire the knowledge and competencies, and at the same time expecting them to encash the same thing when they go to the job market? Now the process of accreditation, they do it in different stages like what we do. Initial stage of registration is there, and they call it as a pre-assessment stage, where submission of pre-qualifiers, submission of 10% of total accreditation fee, then the assessment stage will start. Once the pre-qualifiers are approved, like in NAC, we say 25% is eligible. If they have got that, they can go to the next stage in the same way here. The institution is required to submit remaining 90% of the fee for the programs whose pre-qualifiers are approved. And visiting to the institution for accreditation, once the institution confirms the visit date, NBA constitutes the visit team like NAC peer team. A typical accreditation visit is for 3 days. The visit team consists of a chairperson and 2 program evaluators for each program. Like we also will follow the more or less the same procedure here, like that of the NBA. Then post-assessment stage, once the accreditation visit is completed, the experts prepare the evaluation report and submit to the NBA. Then continuation of accreditation. Institutions that have already been granted accreditation for a period of 3 years are required to submit the compliance report at least 6 months before the expiry and validity of accreditation, along with the compliance fee. On receipt of compliance report, a 2-member visiting team, not the 3, of experts is constituted by NBA for the visit of the respective institution. The report of the visiting team is considered by the consent committee in NBA for continuation. I think in NAC also we say, after the first cycle, the institution will be having a internal quality assurance cell, and thereby they form a committee consisting of all experts. They are supposed to monitor, and every year, whatever the different activities they do, it in order to improve the quality, they have to submit the annual quality assurance report to the NAC. Like that, if we come across all 5 reports, at the end of the 5th year, whatever the content, evidences that they have provided in the name of AQR may go for the SSR. Similarly, here also they follow. A slight variation may be there. Otherwise, the philosophy and the spirit more or less the same. Now, friends, here, before I could pass on to the next one, some of the informations, whatever I have given, it to the best of my knowledge, I have just shared, but it is possible that some rules and regulations must have been changed recently. They were kindly referred to the websites of NAC, you can refer. Then you can refer to the website of NIRF. You also can refer to the website of NBA to update your knowledge by means of which you will get an idea, a comparative idea, so that if you are going for one type of accreditation, better you have some basic knowledge about the parameters used in the other accrediting agencies, so that that may help you to perform better, by means of which you can have a better grade and a better percentage of marks. Now, the third one today, whatever I am going to touch upon, is about the ranking of world universities. Friends, everywhere people are talking, even in some of our programs also, I have come across professors asking me questions like, how is that in India, higher education institutions are not coming one among the 200 higher education institutions which comes under the world ranking? How is it so? Now, recently, the Indians of Science, Indians of Technology, some of these national institutes of importance, they are competing, they are coming up. We are improving. We are confident that shortly, I think some of our universities may also be listed in the world rank, maybe in 200 or so. Let us hope. Let us be optimistic. But at the same time, one should know how exactly the different agencies for world ranking of universities, how do they do this? I think that knowledge, friends, in my opinion, most of the people may not be having a clear-cut knowledge. I am also a learner in that direction. Unless you know those parameters, unless you know those key indicators, unless you know the metrics, what they follow, and unless you understand the conceptual clarity based on which that they are expecting institutions to report to them, it may not be possible for us to score more. That may be the reasons why we are not able to come one among the top 200 universities. Because some of them, like Harvard or MIT or Oxford or the National Singapore University, some of them have been existing since many, many, many years. Therefore, they know what that they have to do. Most of these universities which are coming within 200, in my opinion, they have got a clear-cut idea about the different parameters, whatever that they are using, whereas we are still yet to know. If I am starting a small hotel today, and after 3 years, if I say my hotel is going to be 3-star hotel, is it possible so quickly within 3 years? Or within 10 years, my hotel is going to be 3-star or 5-star? Maybe possible with little exception, but in majority of the cases it may not be so, because it takes time. Time is one factor, mobility and the resources is another factor. So many other factors are there. Unless you address to those factors, it may be very difficult to do it. Anyhow, with this background, I wanted to just share few aspects regarding the ranking of world universities, how they are doing. A basic knowledge I would like to provide. Have this knowledge, then you can proceed, collect the information and see whether you will be comfortable in doing justice to those parameters. Now here, the ARW is most a common agency that is responsible in ranking the universities all over the world. And it is also called Shanghai Ranking Consultancy. Shanghai Ranking Consultancy. It does academic ranking of world universities. Therefore, you can refer, through that you will come to know which are the universities which are on the top in technical universities. Usually we come across maybe Korea, maybe China, maybe Singapore, then Melbourne, Australia, then US. So many of these top countries, developed countries, are doing very well in this. But you can also have a clear-cut idea about how they are doing. Then how they are preparing, it is very interesting to know. There are people who are ready to share this knowledge technically. Of course, some of them may charge little fees, that is a different thing, but there are people who have got very good knowledge about these aspects. The second one, what do you call that agency, like we have got NAC, like we have got NBA, like we have got NIRF, like that, they are also having the different agencies. The second one, the World University Rankings, that is reported by Times Higher Education. Times Higher Education also comes out with a report which gives information regarding different world universities rankings. The other one is called the QS World University Ranking. This is also quite popular. It is started by Coquerelli Siemens, they have tried this. They have followed different mechanisms, different parameters, and they are quite famous. And you can refer to the QS World University rankings. How do they do? Very interesting to know. And many aspects are there, including the finance part, many aspects which I'll be discussing a little bit later. Then ranking web of world universities, Cybermetrics Lab is another one, which also has some yardstick to rank the universities. Then CHE, Center for Higher Education, they also say CHE Excellence Ranking. They call their ranking as CHE Excellence Ranking, and you can just find out how they are doing. Then there are some journals are also available on this, you can just check. Then Good University Guides, options in Australia, they are doing this under the heading Good Universities Guides. They call it as a guide that gives a lot of information. Then Maclean's University Ranking, Maclean's Canada, they also will be just sharing. Canada, each country can have its own popular one, like how we are having in India, NAC. The Good University Guide and the Guardian University Guide, they follow in UK. Then similarly, India Today rankings, like India Today, it also ranks, it gives information about the universities and colleges. And many of our educators, they say, we got the fourth rank announced in India Today. We got the 17th in management course and the 12th in science, third in humanities, something like that. They come across all this information. JMA college ranking is also one among them. Therefore, they are all some of the agencies through which higher education institutions in abroad, they apply and they'll be getting, and the ranks will be listed, and a lot of benefits will be there for people to utilize these ranks. And the institution also gets a lot of benefits by referring to the ranks that was published by the public organizations, public in the sense private also. Then, what are the different criteria they follow? I have referred to this QS World University Ranking. These parameters may slightly vary, but I have referred to this one World University's ranking, that QS ranking. What criteria they follow in order to rank the universities under the World University's ranking? Number one, teaching, of course. Teaching is very, very important, whether it is a college or a university or a school. Teaching is an important part, and it is something like the main heart of the university, the teaching and learning process. The second one, they have given the weightage of research, because when we think of teaching, here they assume that the curriculum is there behind the teaching, because without the curriculum, how can we teach? Therefore, it is already referring to that. Implicit. Then the next one, they speak about the research, about teaching, ending up with the research, or teaching, collaborating with the research, or teaching, tying up with the research. Therefore, they go together. Then the third one is about the citation. How exactly these universities are visible to the outside world? How are they visible to the communities? How are they visible to the industries? Very important. Next criteria, what they follow is about the industry income. Therefore, here also, they say industry income. How much of income the industry is going to get? Because universities are supposed to provide and create new knowledge. Any new knowledge is created, I think many industries are waiting in order to encash that new knowledge for getting economic benefits. Therefore, industry income is given more weightage there. I think, see, recently we are talking about industry-academia relationship. Even our NAC criteria also we are having. Do we have MOU with industries? Do we have some kind of tie-ups with industries? Only at a peripheral level, we are touching upon a little bit here. Whereas when you think of the higher universities abroad, of course, most of them are surrounded by many universities, and India is an agrarian country. We cannot compare ourselves with that of the European countries or that of the other countries where they basically depend upon industries' income. But however, they are keeping this. The next one can be international outlook. International outlook, internationalization of education. I think the whole world is shrinking because of globalization. They wanted to influence not only their country, they want to influence the neighboring countries in terms of education. That's why World Bank is there. World Bank giving lot of financial assistance because they want to encourage all the countries to grow, all the countries to come together, and all the countries to contribute to the best of their ability and best of their potential. Then similarly, international outlook I mentioned, then overall score based upon all these things. Usually they take these five, but each one has got the sub-criteria or key indicators like. The academic ranking of world universities here, it considers 13 separate performance indicators to judge universities against their key missions, including teaching, research, knowledge transfer, international outlook. These performance indicators are grouped into five areas. Therefore, these five areas, whatever I have mentioned, I am highlighting it here once again. Number one is the teaching or the learning environment. Teaching and learning will go. They are something like the two sides of the same coin. A good teaching results in good learning. If good learning is happening, good teaching is also taking place. Therefore, they are given 30% of weightage. Out of 100 marks, 30 marks like. Then little more breakup is also there for the 30. The reputation survey, they conduct a reputation survey, and accordingly they are going to find out in the reputation survey how much marks that they are getting. But they are given 15% weightage for that reputation survey. Staff to student ratio, like here also we follow in our NAC accreditation, NERF accreditation, 4.5%. Doctorate to bachelor's ratio, I think 2.25%. Doctorates awarded to academic staff ratio, we also must have taken that idea, 6%. Institutional income, 2.25% only they have given. Out of 30, for institutional income only 2.25%, because all institutions, higher education institutions may not get that kind of the financial resources. Therefore, 30 for this broader five indicators or categories that they have given under the first one. The second one is with respect to research I mentioned here. Under that, the reputation survey they conduct with respect to research, 18% marks out of the total 30%. Then research income, friend, this is equally important. In NAC also we speak consultancy. Do you have consultancy schemes in your university? How many consultants are there? How much of income you are deriving through consultancy? I think in NAC we are insisting upon that. Similarly, they also will say research income. If your students have conducted some 200 researchers, then how many people have taken, patent you may be having, how many people have taken benefits out of that? Have they utilized your research findings? Are they getting economically benefit? If they have economically benefited, how much in turn they can provide in terms of the researches or some profit, whatever they get, some percentage to the university, very important research income. Research productivity, 6% now, how much is your research production? Now friends, in that way, 30% for the research. I think how much weightage here also in our NAC, third criteria is upon research consultants and extension, we have given weightage here. The third one is about the citation. That is research influence, how far your publications have brought citations. I think that counts quite a lot, because through citation, we will come to know how you are reaching the common people, reaching the public, reaching the authors, reaching the scholars. There were 30% weightage. Then international outlook in terms of staff, students, research, 7.5%. Then promotion of international students, under that you have got 2.5% for that. Proportion of international staff members. Now this is equally, I have come across some of the deemed universities, they prefer to appoint two foreign staff members. I was asking them, why do you? In India only I've got so many staff members, they are searching for the job, why can't you provide opportunity, let them grow? They said, no sir, if you attract the people from outside, our students will get lot of benefit. In the mixed approach, in the hybrid approach now, we want our students to get the benefit from knowledge, skills and competencies of our Indian teachers as well as foreign teachers. So for somewhere or the other, they have got that kind of international outlook to appoint the staff members and attract the international students. I think as I mentioned earlier, if an Indian wanted to go and study abroad, either in MIT or maybe in Oxford or maybe in Harvard, he has to spend lakhs together. Whereas people from outside, they can come here because dollars to rupees, it is easy. But thereby, I think many universities have got some schemes, some MOUs attracting the students. Therefore, if you wanted to go for international ranking, you have to keep this point also in mind. Already we have started, but we have to go a little more with a lot of rigor. Then international collaborations, 2.5% weightage for the international collaboration, how much of a collaboration that you are having internationally, with how many foreign universities you are having. Somewhere I mentioned, when people are talking about we are not getting that rank one among the 200, I said, how many of you have contacted the foreign universities to have MOU with those universities which are one among the top 200? Have you tried? I think here is an important point to share. If you can try with those universities, they can share some of their internal secrets of getting a better grade or better rank. You also can get the benefit and you can do it with the collaboration. Industry income, they have got only 2.5% as I mentioned. If an institution does not teach undergraduates, only teaches a narrow subject area or does not produce a large number of research articles, it will not be considered in these rankings. Very, very important this point. This means that certain smaller or highly specialized institutions might not be included here. That means unless your institution through your undergraduates or postgraduate students introducing a different type of subject which has got a lot of demand and a lot of publications in highly referred journals, maybe like Springer and other journals, I think more weightage will be there. Therefore, industrial income, wherein you are going to transfer your knowledge in order to get the income, that is also there. Now, friends, that is what I have just mentioned. I think some universities like Tsinghua University, China, National University of Singapore, University of Melbourne, Hong Kong University, University of Hong Kong, Hong Kong, then Peking University, China, Nanyang Technological University, Singapore, Australian National Universities, Chinese University of Hong Kong. I have taken few, but there are other lists also about European countries, then developing countries now. You can kindly refer to it and you'll be getting a lot of information regarding that. Now, friends, lastly, maybe another 5 minutes, I am going to just wind up. What are the benefits of accreditation? Already we have mentioned that in our website. Determining whether an institution is meeting standards of education. I think that is best. You will get that kind of benefit. Improving enrollment rate by winning the trust of the students and parents. Another advantage. Helping employees to determine the different types of programs and their credibility through that. Another benefit. Enables graduates to appear for further certification and examinations. Therefore, if you are in an accredited institution, they introduce a lot of value-added courses, certificate courses, where the students can get a lot of benefit out of it. Accelerate the chances of placements in institutions. I think a lot of demand will be there. Highly accredited institution, many industry people will go there saying that we want students from your university only. It is something like, tell me your university, I will tell you the possibility of providing a job to you. It's very interesting. If students are going for interview, some people in humorous will say, tell me your university, I'll tell you the possibility of getting a job to you. I think somewhere connected there. Creates goals for self-employment of education institutions. Determine whether an institution is meeting the standards, as I said earlier. Some of these benefits, in addition to it, I have just mentioned, stakeholders' implication is there. Present students and graduates you can attract easily. Prospective students will apply for these. Professional and professional societies will have a greater perception toward these institutions. Licensing bodies will come forward, like a research grant the funding agency. Immediately, if we say our institution is internationally recognized, a lot of funds will flow, research funds will flow, employment opportunities for placement will be more. Then government agencies will come forward, and so many other benefits are there. Therefore, now to conclude today, I have given brief information regarding the different accrediting agencies, including some of the agencies which are trying their best, keeping different kinds of criteria by means of which they can rank the universities. It is for the universities, it is for the concerned state government, central government, and it is for the stakeholders to value those ranks and accordingly act. I think that's what I wanted to just share with all of you. And I think this is an interesting thing to conclude. Knowing the accrediting agency, what you have to do, try to know the different accrediting agencies where you wanted to apply for accreditation. Acquaint the parameters or criteria. Participate in the awareness or training program, which is equally important. Studies have revealed institutions where the members have been trained, possibility of getting higher grade is more. Institutions where their staff members or teachers have not been trained, less probability. Interact with the experts who have involved in the process of accreditation. Interact with the higher education institutions which have been already participated. So try to have contact with the institutions which have got a better grade or let us say high ranking from other agencies. Take some tips, take some suggestions, invite them and utilize their services with lot of records so that your institution also will go plan, prepare and execute. If you do so, you get accreditation. If you get accreditation, you smile. Look at the smile. Therefore, all institutions, if you want to smile like that, you have to do lot of work, lot of groundwork, lot of effort you have to put now. I think that makes you too. So this is what I want to just share with you. Thank you very much for listening to me. Thank you. Samuel, over to Samuel.
Yeah, we'll like to take some questions from the audience.
Yes.
So, to start with, I'll just go through the Q&A section if at all there is any questions. And if any participant want to ask any question, you may raise your hands. There is an option in the application using which you can raise your hand so that we'll unmute you and you can ask a question directly to the panelist. So to start with, there is one person who has asked for please comment on quality assessment. Anyways, I think the whole session is based on that one only. So I think more questions are there. So Shekhar Ranjan, you have been unmuted. You may ask your question.
Yeah.
Yeah. You tell me.
The research income and research productivity.
Yeah.
This is not very, very clear to me.
Okay. Now, research income and research productivity. Correct. No, I think good. You have asked a nice question. But in research productivity, I think they are a little bit connected, but still they are distinct. Research income means, like I have done research and I got patent for it. Some industries are coming forward in order to get my intellectual idea under in the name of Intellectual Property Act. I think you are familiar. Therefore, in my university, there are few people who have done wonderful, unique work, and they wanted to share that for the industries which are going to get monetary benefit. In that way, we are going to have an MOU with those organizations wherein we get financial benefit for the university, and the university will just share that knowledge to them, skills to them, competences to them. I think research income can be derived through this. Research productivity means any kind of research you do, it should lead to production. Production of what? According to me, knowledge production it can be, skill production it can be, or it can be a production which leads to economic benefit. Therefore, otherwise in most of the universities, many students will take up research in order to get degrees, but ultimately, what about the implications of their findings? Out of 100, not even 5 theses, and their findings will go to industry or will go to the society for different purposes. That is not happening. That's why people will say, if you want your research to be productive in nature, either in the name of fundamental research producing the new knowledge, or maybe in the name of research that gives way for economic benefit, you have to do. Without that, for the sake of degree, if you are doing, I think students may get the degree, but ultimately we are not going to get any benefit. Therefore, kindly keep these 2 points. Research doing, functional research, felt-based research, research which gives some kind of income to the university. But our objective is not to make people to take up the research to produce income, to get income, no. But do it, but ultimately it should end up with that. Then research productivity means be conscious in assigning the different types of research projects to the people so that it will be productive in nature in terms of knowledge, skills, and economic aspects. Thank you. Good question. I liked it.
We go to the next person, Kasturi SVS. Kasturi SVS, you may ask a question. You have been unmuted.
Yeah, Kasturi.
Yeah, we'll go ahead, sir. Dr. Emmanuel, Father Emmanuel, you may ask a question.
Yeah, Father Emmanuel.
Yeah, I have seen so many agencies outside India who are doing ranking.
Yes.
In India, you mentioned about India Today, JAM College ranking. Is there any other agency that is doing ranking for universities?
To my knowledge, I think I am not familiar, but always I used to depend upon these sources to know about the universities. I am not, but still we can find out further. That's what I can just say.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But opportunities are there. For your question, if some of the agencies, those who are having a good database, tools wherein they can get the data, they can structure the data, and through that it is possible for some agencies, it is a potential area, but provided they have to prove their worthiness, that they are capable of coming out with the parameters based upon the output given by the experts. Like that, lot of scope is there for a few more agencies also to come, but national education policy is insisting that little more accrediting agencies should come. Therefore, we are not very sure who are going to be. And I think NAC, NAAC, National Education Policy suggests that NAC should also change its role and function in terms of NAC only, National Accrediting Council, NAC, but not NAAC. In the light of that, there can be some kind of possibility.
Yeah,
I am not very sure.
Why India has no universities that is coming in the world ranking.
Correct. We are looking for it, Father. We are waiting. Let us see. But apart from that, prevent people also, if they feel that they have got the potentials to do it, I think nothing wrong if they come. Okay. Any other question?
Kasturi SVS. Kasturi SVS, you may ask a question. You have been unmuted. Maybe she is having some audio problem, sir.
Yeah, maybe. Okay.
Yeah. Questions are over, sir. There are one more raised hand is there. Professor okay. Mohammad Ahmad Khan. Professor Mohammad Ahmad Khan.
Yes, I am Professor from Kashmir University. I really want to say that so far as productivity is concerned in research and it is used by the stakeholders, usually much depends upon the government for fund later on. Say for example, a study is conducted on effect of counseling on underachievers. Means then finally we give government that at least appoint a counselor in a particular on every school or at least in high schools, that better dividends and personal and educational and vocational problem be addressed. But as it demands the appointment of a counselor and the money is involved, there the research that has been conducted on experimental level and dividends were better, but that remains on shelf. Therefore, finances are, my, to my knowledge, in objects wherever the in is needed after research has been conducted is from the government, which usually then is somehow minimal.
I think Ahmad,
so what is your take on that account, sir?
No, I think I appreciate the way in which you have analyzed, but here I did not mention, by conducting research in social science is different. Conducting research in the science areas like physics, chemistry, botany, zoology, or maybe microbiology or technology, they are different. Therefore, that difference is always there. But depending upon the area of research, one has to try to find out what way they can encourage the research so that it yields to. As you said very rightly, in social science, some problems related to inclusiveness, for example, if some research, the findings will give way and we can apply for the government, these are the findings to improve upon those people or that particular category, we want the fund. Therefore, the ultimately your research also may help the government to support your research projects or research by providing financial assistance. That's why many are coming forward to do it. Like, for example, ICSSR is there. Therefore, they encourage the people to take up the project and they finance the project in terms of lakhs that they are doing. In the same way, in science also, they can do it. Therefore, depending upon what type of research, in what disciplines that the research is happening. Otherwise, as you said rightly, in social science, you apply, take the help of the government, by means of which you can contribute much better in that particular direction and serve the society. In science and pure sciences, no, lot of demand is there. Lot of demand is there, as you know, in science. Lot of money comes in. Technology, lot of money comes in. In that way, I agree with you. Therefore, I have not distinct the social science research from that of the science research or the scientific research. Thank you, sir. Good point. Yeah. Samuel?
There is one raised hand, Dr. Mohinder.
Yes, Samuel. Sir, I want to ask that in light of the national education policy which is coming up now, what possible changes we expect in the assessment and accreditation process, sir? I want to know that. Thank you.
You have asked a very nice application question to me, but may be difficult. But however, I think I gave a clue also there. NAAC to NAAC, I mentioned. Meta accrediting body. NAAC is going to be a meta accreditation body. And keeping that in mind, we will be having the different accrediting agencies. This is what I am predicting. This is my personal opinion. They were depending upon the roles and functions of different accrediting agencies. And depending upon the roles and functions of the meta accrediting body, we have to define where exactly we require modification in terms of the criteria. Therefore, I think one possibility, we have to look into the criteria. Unless we know the different accrediting agencies and their functions, it may be very difficult. For example, hitherto NAAC is performing the ANDA process, keeping the expectations of the institutions on one hand and the quality parameters on the other hand, they should do it. But now in the change of the national education policy, what they have suggested, we have to work out clearly with respect to the roles and functions. Then accordingly, when an accrediting agency is going, if I am going to a technical education, what should be my parameters? If I am going to a general education university, what should be my parameters? Like that, how the variations are there. In the same way, among the parameters, number one, then within the key indicators, there is a possibility of bringing some changes. I think that is what experts are thinking about it. I think it takes little time to materialize, because unless these things are very clear, in my opinion, it may be very difficult to suggest. We may be too early to say, this change you can bring, this change you can bring. Too early. But however, The purpose is to check the quality of the institution. Quality of the institution, major changes may not happen, according to me personally. Major changes may not happen because all the aspects we have taken care. Curriculum, teaching, learning, research we have taken. Then infrastructure aspect we have taken. Then institutional distinctiveness, best practices. But slight modification in terms of criteria, maybe one criteria may be added. Some more indicators may be changed here and there. I think that possibility is there. Now too early, madam. Sir, Mahendra, no? Too early and you have to excuse. Let us wait and see. Thank you.
Couple of more questions you may take. Ajay Mishra, you have been unmuted. You may ask a question. Ajay Mishra.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Hello. Go ahead, sir.
Thank you, Professor Dr. Srikanth Swami, for such a nice presentation on this, for enlightening us for different actually ranking system like NAC, NIRF, and world ranking system also. So during as you are telling that in the world ranking system, you know, our university do not come up among the 200 university. This is maybe due to some that so far we do not understand the metrics they have used. Or we have to work out. But if I ask the same question to you, you know, in the NAC procedure, if you if you have done a lot of metric system, and if you judge the with the metric system, if you judge the say Jawaharlal Nehru University at the same time with the same metric system, if you judge some university in the Jharkhand or in the some backward area, do you think that it is really will be good judgment for those universities who are situated in the backward areas?
Yeah, Mishraji, it's a nice question. I appreciate. This is what I think our director of our NAC, Karmaji, he believes in it. He says rural universities cannot be compared with the city universities, if I am correct. That's what his perception. Then he says, though the measuring yards are same, you cannot have a different set of criteria for rural university or rural college and different set of criteria for urban. In my opinion, you cannot have. It is something like suggesting rural textbooks and urban textbooks in engineering. Can you suggest a rural textbook for engineering student and an urban textbook for an engineering student of computer science? Whether he is in the rural area or the urban area, computer science is computer science in the same way. But however, there is a need for the institution to convince them, the PRT members, or whenever they are providing the data, they have to convince that since it is in the rural area, these are some of the issues, these are some of the problems. In that way, NAC is also aware, all my respected advisors are aware, PRT members are aware. When they go for that, they do not compare mechanically, as you said, sir. Mishraji, you can trust now, they do not compare. Therefore, they go to a rural, they keep that background also in mind, and with that they go. They adopt little bit flexibility towards it. As you said now, we should, though the criteria, other things are same, we should not completely adhere to the parameters, what we implement, what we expect in the urban side to the rural side. This is my personal opinion. Therefore, they don't do it, in my opinion, many experts. But here and there, institution also may fail to convince them about their problems. PRT members may fail to understand their problems. In that process, it is possible that the institution may not get some points as they have expected there. Otherwise, you can trust that PRT members are aware about this issue, including our director. We wanted to help the rural universities, maybe tribal universities. That's why special financial assistance is also given to all those tribal and other areas coming forward to conduct training and awareness programs. That's why money, financial assistance is also given by the NAC. Therefore, that may not be true. But however you said, we should not compare like that. I also agree with you. But experts always, they move, keeping that difference in mind. That geographical difference, as you said rightly, urban facilities are different, rural facilities are different, like internet connections and other things different. Or you think of some kind of water management. In some places, like hot places, it is very difficult for them to get water. What type of management they do with the water? like that, those issues are there. That's why whenever they are providing the evidences, institution should be sincere enough to provide, and at the same time, peer team members also, in my opinion, they will take care of those things because experienced people are going and they do justice to it. So well, let us not be biased, Mishraji, but I agree with you. I agree with your nice point. Thank you.
Last question we'll take, sir.
Yeah.
Vanaja Mahadasu. Vanaja, you have been unmuted. You may ask you a question.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah, good evening.
Sir, I am a professor of education. My query is related to the accreditation of teacher education institutions, sir.
Okay.
Will it be separate or something? Just throw light so that we get some ideas.
Yeah, one is already in our website we have mentioned for teacher education institutions. NAC has taken the responsibility of conducting encouraging the teacher education institutions to apply for accreditation. Already there are around 9 higher education teacher education institutions have come forward and they wanted to apply on their own. They are coming. There is no compulsion. NCT is not insisting. Therefore, the institutions are coming on their own because through accreditation they will come to know where they are in terms of their quality parameters and what of benefit that they can also derive in case they get a better grade. Therefore, it is open. You also can apply for the NAC accreditation. And we have kept this teacher education manual also on our website. Kindly go through it. Acquaint yourselves how exactly slight modifications we have done with respect to the metrics of teacher education. Slight variation is there when compared to university and the college manual. Slight variation, kindly look into it. It is open, you can come. Only teacher education universities people, they have to gear up. They have to utilize the opportunity to come forward and then do it. That's what my session. Thank you, Vanita, for asking that. And go ahead and prove yourself that you will apply, come to the NAC.
That is all from my side. I request Shyam Singh to take it forward.
Thank you, Samuel. Okay, fine.
Thank you, Mr. Samuel. Feeling gratitude but not expressing, it's like wrapping the present but not gifting it. A very good evening to all the delegates and the participants. I would like first of all to thank the Honorable Director, Professor S.C. Sharma Ji, for Sir's continued support and encouragement for organizing this webinar. Sir enlightened us on the qualitative initiatives in higher education and how best we can put our efforts in making changes in society we live. We are indeed thankful to Professor Ganesh Hegdeji, the advisor NAC, for his opening remarks. I would like to place my special thanks to Dr. Shrikanta Swami, sir, where sir, you have specifically highlighted on NRF, the parameters, methodology, features, ranking of world universities, general criteria for ranking of universities, citations, international outlook, benefits of accreditation, to name a few. We are indeed thankful for you for your knowledge sharing and the words of wisdom, sir. On behalf of NAC, a hearty thanks to all the participants for their gracious presence, participation and support for organizing this webinar. Special thanks to the ICT team, Professor Amaya Kumar Rath, Mr. Samuel, NAC officers, advisors, deputy advisors, assistant advisors, and all support staff who helped in organizing this webinar. Last but not the least, we are thankful to each and everybody who were directly and indirectly involved in making this event a grand success. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Ramya Kumar, Samuel, and my friends.